Hello, everyone. Welcome. Glad you're here. Welcome back, I should say, to the 2016-17 InPrint Margarett Root Brown Reading Series. My name is Rich Levy. I'm Executive Director of InPrint, Houston's premier nonprofit literary arts organization. And we're glad you're here in the beautiful Alley Theater. Thank you. Both in person and by live stream. Since 1980, this series has presented more than 350 great writers from 28 countries, an essential joy for folks like us for whom the written word is both a personal matter and a thing to be shared. Thank you this evening for joining with us around our literary campfire. Tonight, we are honored and happy to welcome Rabih Alameddine and Juan Gabriel Vasquez to Houston and to the InPrint Margarett Root Brown Reading Series, presenting their new novels, The Angel of History and Reputations. Next up in the series, on January 23rd, the great writer Annie Prue will read from her new novel, Barkskins. This will be her first visit to Houston since 1995. Tickets go on sale on the InPrint website tomorrow at noon, and then I hope you'll join us for the rest of the season. We have evenings with George Saunders, Ada Limon, Gregory Pardlow, Cullum Tobin. We're going to have fun. So extraordinary writers sharing extraordinary books. I hope you'll join us. General admission tickets, as many of you know, are $5. They go fast, so please buy yours early and often. All the details, plus many diverting links, are at inprinthouston.org. You're also invited to the InPrint Book Club on Sunday, December 11th, at InPrint House, to discuss Ann Patchett's Commonwealth. And rumor has it, oh, there's a little snowflake from... This is Christmas Carol, right? At any moment, the ghost of Christmas past will emerge. Be careful. Rumor has it that afterward, the book club will retire to someplace nearby for a cup of holiday cheer. See our website, inprinthouston.org, where you can also join the email list and follow us on Facebook and Twitter. The InPrint Margarett Root Brown Reading Series is presented by InPrint in association with Brazos Bookstore and the University of Houston Creative Writing Program. This series is made possible by the generous support, there's more snow, of the Brown Foundation, named for one of its founding trustees, Margarett Root Brown. This series is also underwritten by Weatherford International and the National Endowment for the Arts, which affirms that art works. We owe thanks to Grove Atlantic and Riverhead, Rabih's and Juan's publishers, and United Airlines, MM Properties, and Wind Park for their in-kind support. InPrint receives funding from the City of Houston through the Houston Arts Alliance and from the Texas Commission on the Arts. Special thanks also to folks who helped us get the word out about tonight's reading: the Arab American Cultural and Community Center, Casa Cultural de las Americas, Litoral Latin American Voices, the French Consulate of Houston, and the Texan French Alliance for the Arts. We appreciate your help. And big thanks, as always, to our season ticket buyers. Tonight, we are excited to live stream this reading with Houston Public Media, to whom we are deeply grateful. Nothing, as you know, compares to the real thing. I'm not sure they could see the snowflakes out there. But if you know folks who wanted to be with us tonight and weren't able to make it, please let them know. They can catch the live stream on the InPrint or the Houston Public Media websites. Thanks also to the Alley for their assistance. After the reading tonight, Juan and Rabih will have a conversation here on stage with fiction writer, poet, and children's author Chitra Devakaruni, professor at the UH Creative Writing Program. Then we'll move out to the lobby by the bar for a book sale and signing. Brazos Bookstore offers discounts on books by InPrint series authors, and tonight they have for sale signed copies of Juan's and Rabih's books. Finally, please set your phones on stun or silent mode. Also, no flash photos and no recording except for those authorized to do so. Thank you. Rabih Alameddine, who lives in San Francisco, says he fits in the U.S. where he doesn't belong, but belongs in Beirut, where he doesn't fit. Born in Amman, Jordan, he was raised in Kuwait and Lebanon, studied in England and the US, earning degrees in engineering and business. After stints of work and further study, he became a painter with solo shows in New York and London before publishing his first novel, Kool-Aid's The Art of War, in 1998. Fortunately for us, Rabih has stayed with writing. His third novel, The Hakawadi, The Storyteller, gained international acclaim. Amy Tan wrote, Rabih Alameddine is the Hakawadi, and in the very near future, everyone will know how to pronounce his name. Rachel Kushner called his novel An Unnecessary Woman Magnificent, and Yi-Yun Lee described Alameddine as that rare writer who not only breaks our hearts, but gives every broken piece a new life. Houston Chronicle book editor Allison Ward calls his new book, The Angel of History, ingenious, a richly textured novel that is a remarkable feat of imagination and a cry to remember. Juan Gabriel Vasquez comes to us tonight from his native city of Bogota, Colombia. Juan earned his law degree in Bogota and then moved to Paris, where he studied at the Sorbonne and received a doctorate in Latin American literature. After 16 years in France, Belgium, and Spain, he returned to Colombia in 2012. The Informers, his first novel translated into English, arrived in 2009 to great critical acclaim. Mario Vargas Llosa called him one of the most original new voices of Latin American literature. His third novel in translation, The Sound of Things Falling, earned lavish praise and became a bestseller. Edmund White in the New York Times Book Review described it as brilliant and gripping, and Lev Grossman in Time Magazine wrote, Vasquez is a master stylist who, like Bolaño, uses the novel to map the deep, cascading damage done to our world by greed and violence, and to concede that even love cannot repair it. Tonight, he presents his novel, Reputations, New in English, which the New York Times calls masterly and NPR describes as a powerful, concentrated achievement that makes clear that our memories, even the things we've forgotten, can come back to haunt us and make us question the true cost of our actions. Please give a warm Houston welcome to these two singular and wonderful writers whose work is more vital than ever, Rabih Alameddine and Juan Gabriel Vasquez. And first up, Rabih.
Hi. Although I had to say, I'm slightly disappointed that the snowflakes started falling before I got on stage. Actually, the other thing, before I start, first, thank you so much for coming. I wouldn't show up to one of my readings, so it's always a surprise when other people do. But I was warned. I was talking to a friend of mine, and we were talking about Satan in literature and art, because this book, Satan, is one of the characters. And she was telling me that there was this puppet show in Texas where somebody actually shot this puppet of Satan. So, before you shoot, I can put the book right here. So, let me read. I will read two segments. The most important thing, or the only thing you really need to know, is that the narrator is talking to his lover who has been dead for about 20 years. The first segment is called Restless Heart. The beating of your heart kept me awake one night. For months after you died, I saw you everywhere. Heard your voice, sonorous, throaty, reverberating in my ear. I wasn't crazy. I knew you were dead. I buried you after all. I mean, I burned you, cremated you. But I kept seeing you, doing dishes in the kitchen with your back to me. I'd call you as you stacked each plate in our plastic dish rack. but you didn't look back. And then you were gone in a flash, and I was left with nothing, not even an after image. I didn't mistake you for anybody. I never saw you in a crowd thinking someone else was you. No, it was never like that. I saw you in the hallway, in our hallway, under the Turkish lamp you brought back from Istanbul when you were there so long ago. Remember the trouble they gave you at customs for a $20 lamp? And you emerged from the swinging doors. You were furious. I kept telling you to calm down, but you wouldn't. You went on and on because you were angry and you were an American and you could ruffle feathers at airports. While I was alive, I loved you while you were alive, and I loved you still, but I forgot for a while. Forgive me. I couldn't obsess about you all the time, so you disappeared as if I'd bleached my memory, but you came back, you know, like a fungal infection. Remember Thrush, the white stains that attacked your innocent tongue? Looked like snowy down on old strawberries. We couldn't get rid of it, and you hated it, and I hated it, and you wanted it over. When, to make you feel better, I joked that the furry fungus matched your white lab coat, you turned apoplectic. Wanted to strangle me. I still regret that. I thought it was funny at the time. You'd been gone for decades. You hit deep in my legs. Why now? Why infect my dreams now? What flood is this? Once, as I was buying groceries in a store where a young third worlder mopped the floor back and forth, around a yellow sign that announced piso mojado, the mephitic aroma of disinfected assaulted my senses, and you jumped the levee of my memory. Proust had his Madeleine, but bleach was all ours, Doc, all ours. The tomatoes didn't look too good, and I just went home. I'd been a coward. I was scared. Do notice I said scared and not frightened. You taught me the difference. You said children get scared. Men might feel afraid, might even feel terror, but men don't get scared. I'd been so lonely since you died. You left me roofless in a downpour. You gripped the bed rail when you took your final breath, and I had to pry open your fingers one by one to free you. It took 17 minutes because my hands were shaking so much. Even in death, you were stronger than I and more obstinate. The mortician told me it took forever to burn you. Thrice he had to put you in the incinerator. You refused to turn to ash. You sincerely believed the distance between you and me would one day disappear. You told me I was not my mother and you were not my father. How could we not be? How could we not be? The stones over her cenotaph still felt so very heavy. You held out your arm and said, "Join me," but I couldn't. And you said, "Let me love you," and I couldn't because you wanted to be so close. You held out the fireman's net and said, "Jump," and I couldn't. I felt the fall was much too great. I chose to go back into the fire. You said, "I like it when you doze on my chest," but I said, "The hair on your chest irritates my cheeks and makes it difficult to sleep." I could hardly bear the beauty of you. You were gone for so long, and I moved along, and everyone told me I was alive. But that night, in my bed, each time my ear touched the single pillow, I heard your heartbeat once more, once more, once more, once more. My heart is restless until it rests in thee. On that happy note. You're an easy audience. Where I come from, we heckle much better. This section is called The Whorehouse. And it's not G-rated. And also what's interesting is that I've read this section a couple of times, and every time I come to the whorehouse, for whatever reason, I say the warehouse, which gives it a completely new, different meaning. The whorehouse. High above, in the great altitude of dense Sana'a, you could hardly breathe. But I found it more open than the open open spaces of the rest of the country. A city boy I was, like most before me. Even as a child, I knew I did not fit in bucolic Yemen, its mountains or plains, its deserts or beaches. Sana'a, on the other hand, may have been charmingly beautiful with its historic houses, but it was a city, a non-pretender, bitter and onerous, oppressive, so of course, it felt more natural to me. It was old as well as ancient. The imamate had kept modernity at bay for generations. We did not stay long, but I believe I would have survived there, could have. We arrived in a rickety van covered in dust and sand and soot, whose driver, a weather-wrinkled young man sporting a proud mustache dyed with henna, was forced to jam a screwdriver between the glass and its rubber molding to keep the window ajar. We disembarked in the city with few possessions: the clothes on our back, a most colorful satchel, and my mother's well-functioning. A question here, a whisper there, a lowering of shy eyes, a gasp of surprise, one of delight, a nod in a general direction, a pointed finger, and within minutes of setting our tattered slippers on the city's soil, we were knocking on a pinkish-brown door. I remember every detail of that door. With rows of pomegranates carved into its hardwood, a central jamb studded with tarnished bronze pins that needed a good rub with lemon and coarse sea salt to regain its luster, a knocker through which you could hang a dish towel. I remember every aspect of the house and its eccentric decor. The windows framed by white arches, the indoor fresh fountain, the cupolas above the corridors, all inlaid with small black stones held together with a cement made from white lime. I don't remember much about its inhabitants, a number of Egyptians, army men, engineers, politicians and advisors, evangelists in their recent beliefs, new converts to socialism, pan-Arabism, and buying sex on the cheap. Of course, what may have been a tiny amount of money to the men was abundance to my mother. She offered her charms earnestly and diligently, and luckily for us, another woman visiting the house took a quick fancy to her and to me. Auntie Badia didn't care much for Sana'a or anything it had to offer. For a militant Cairene, every other city paled, and the Yemeni capital felt to her like nothing more than an oversized hamlet. She did not wish to spend a second more than she had to outside of her beloved Cairo. She had come to work with two other women, and she intended to leave Sana'a, the troops, and the two women behind as soon as she made enough money. 3 weeks after we arrived, 3 weeks after my mother had rediscovered her popularity, Auntie Badia offered her the opportunity of the lifetime. Come with me to Cairo. Work in our house. Become acclaimed by real gentlemen for a change, and you don't have to veil your face outdoors. You can wear whatever you want. It is most modern. In Cairo, God wipes the tears off his children's faces. We hardly had time to unpack the one colorful satchel before we were crossing the Red Sea in a rickety boat covered in dust and salt and engine soot. Off to the great modern city we went, to Auntie Badia's house. Faulkner once said that the best job offered to him was in a brothel, and it was the best milieu for an artist to work in. Baudelaire agreed, of course, and I learned about poetry in the whorehouse. My mother, with me in tow, was welcomed probably for the first time in her life. Being pretty, kind, generous, she was well-liked by both the establishment and its customers. Being delusional, slightly unhinged, and indiscreet romantic, she fit right in with the rest of my aunties. She finally found a home. If you ask me, those were the happiest days of my life. We lived in a house with other women who came in all colors and cultures, and like the brothel's furniture, came in all shapes and sizes. My lovely aunties, short and tall aunties, white and black, voluptuous and boyish, Egyptian, Ethiopian, Uzbek, Indian, Yemeni. Most of them, my mother included, sat around in a daze under the hanging lamps, spent half their time in hope and half in waiting. Waiting for a miracle that never visited, waiting for something or someone to fly them out of their adopted life. For my mother, that someone was my father. Someday, her emir would come. And he didn't, of course, and she forever forgave him, or I think she did. Auntie Badia, on the other hand, didn't wait for a miracle. She loved her life, and she loved me. Older than my mother, though not by much, she took me under her wing, more precisely, under her skirt. No, not sexual, Doc. I was much too young, and she didn't have much sex in any case. That's why she had time to look after me. She was dark, darker than me, and overweight, which at one point was popular with clients, primarily Egyptians and other Arabs. But as Russians and Europeans began to frequent the house, she was less desired. She lay beyond their longings. Though she went through the prescribed motions every evening, it was merely gesture, a performance for performance's sake. The motions, including painting her face while the men were already in the room, she was the only one who did that. About an hour after evening prayers, she descended the unbanistered stairs into the salon, splayed herself on a duchesse brisée whose bright canary yellow clashed with every single thing in the room except for the caged canary. Once completely comfortable, her heft proportionally distributed about the unusual chaise longue, a Rubenesque odalisque, Auntie Badia languidly applied her makeup, none of which were store-bought. All natural, organic even. Crushed fruits and berries were the lipstick. In a small wooden bowl, she mixed galena and other powders for the call before her rapt audience, outlined her eyes with a pencil-shaped stick of ivory. I always have to delete this line. European men, Eastern and Western, weren't the only one dazzled by the theater. Americans soon joined them, and I too stood mouth open, eyes wide, nostrils flaring, enraptured by beauty and ignored by the men. I mention your countrymen, Doc, not to make you feel terrible, but for whatever reason, they visited us in disproportionately large numbers, and truly, pleasing them became the main thrust of our establishment. They always overpaid, and because of their lumpen tastes, they weren't difficult to please. Your people and the Europeans loved watching Auntie Badia, were mightily entertained, made sure to arrive early whenever they were bringing a newbie so he could witness her great art. But when it came time to withdraw into the private rooms, they redirected their buzzard eyes. They chose. They sure did. She was younger, prettier, drank Pepsi and 7-Up, blushed easily, covered her mouth when giggling, and had just the right touch of non-threatening exoticness, just a tad. Since my mother was busy most of the time, Auntie Badia took care of me. You would think at some point a younger model would have replaced her, someone who would have been able to provide the house with a steadier and plumper income, but you'd be wrong. Irreplaceable she was. Auntie Badia spoke passable pink in a few languages, including English. Idiosyncratic she was. Those American men loved being around her, found her amusing, if not. Soon after Auntie Badia finished painting her lady face, she'd joke with customers, ruckus and raillery and merriment in broken English, goad the undecided into choosing the right girl for his next orgasm, and sit me on her lap. Well, on her thigh, since she was usually odalisking. Blow on my face, my sweet Ya'ub. The powder has to dry. Sing for me, she'd say. Recite Abu Nawas. I love his poetry, but not as much as I love you. When the audience thinned out, she carried me to the kitchen, fed me, made me read aloud while I stuffed my mouth with her cooking. Poetry, light puerile rhymes at first, more adult as I grew up, but always rhymes. Arabic poetry always rhymed. She put me in her bed, and I slept long before my mother finished satisfying for the night. Auntie Badia usually woke to find me inventing the most elaborate games while sitting on the floor outside my mother's door, serving tea to Sultan Ahmed, who entertained King George of Britannica, the latter so enthralled by my tea-serving prowess that he wished to steal me from my master while I demurred and blushed and covered my mouth and giggled. After my fairly ritualized morning ablutions, brush my teeth, wash my face under my arms, I was forced to read and write in the kitchen while Auntie Badia sang and hovered around pots, heating atop the wood stove, like a mother hen with her chicks. Old Egyptian recipes she cooked, flavored with all Egyptian folk songs. She even sang Yemeni folk songs that she learned during her short stay in Sana'a. Lovely songs, not like Ofra Haza. Remember her, the Israeli singer you used to like to dance to, whom I couldn't stand, but you insisted she was singing Yemeni songs that she heard while growing up in Tel Aviv, because that's what the album cover said in clear lettering. Yet I hadn't heard any of these songs before, and you accused me of being insensitive and racist even. And you made me listen to her over and over and over so I couldn't get the songs out of my head, even though I hated them and I hated her, until she died of AIDS, just like all of us. She was just like us, and I felt so guilty for hating her, and I forgave her sins, but I couldn't forgive mine. Ofra's songs did not compare well with those of Auntie Badia. I couldn't measure up, because Auntie's voice was gravelly like sea pebbles on the beach, ideal for those old melodies. Auntie Badia's sing-song melodies bore me across the grooves of childhood. I sat at the kitchen table with my book or papers waiting. On the wall, an old-fashioned ticking clock, the only visible one since the brothel had Vegas rules. No customer should be allowed to see the time. I waited. I stared back at the hands of the clock, at the black hands of the clock, willing them to move to no avail. I would count to agonizing infinity and back, and look up, and barely a minute had passed. I remember the clock, round, the size of a salad dish, Arabic numbers on the subdued light gray, an oyster-colored background. I remember the pages in front of me, writing the alphabet slowly, the aleph, the standing line, trying to make it fit within the predetermined boundaries, and glancing up at the clock once more and again, understanding that my mother had not woken up. My aunties would stare awake one by one, come down to the late lunch, and my mother would always be the last, always the last. She would be happy to see me, ruffle my most unruffable hair, but she wasn't a day person, and it would take her a few hours to regain full cheerfulness. Her jalabiya was puce. I still see it so clearly, Doc, so clearly. Puce is a French word for flea. It's the color of bloodstains. And was Marie Antoinette's favorite because it was squashed. If you squashed a flea on it, you couldn't see the stain. But even though the whorehouse certainly had its share of fleas, I doubt my mother ever considered the connection. She rarely considered much else than what was directly in front of her, which was where I tried to be. I buzzed around her like a hummingbird around its zinnia. Look at me, look at me. Her head was usually down, hair covered her face. She would grunt, hum, uh-huh, and yes to everything I said until she stabbed my heart with an enough now, or can't you see I'm tired, and I would slouch and begin my second phase of waiting until she recovered and bloomed. Slowly, she perked up and began to smile. And as soon as she was able to pay me some mind, the muezzin's call would echo from the masjid 4 streets away. Time for evening prayers. The only ones that the entire house observed. The prayer rugs unrolled. Auntie Badia owned the most intricate and my favorite. Fine wool woven to depict a white mosque, its blue minaret topped by a delicate cold golden crescent. My mother's barely a step above her straw mat. The woman all lined up facing toward Mecca, their foreheads and noses pressed the rugs thrice, while I remained still behind the murmuring hive so as to not distract their humming hearts promising devotion. I waited impatiently for the ritual to finish, hoping for a few seconds of attention, since the end of prayer was the time to get ready for work and the cycle. The eternal return. The men returned, my auntie preened, evening in full bloom. Auntie Badia descended the stairs. The laughter, the merriment, my mother left with the man. Other couples paired up in rooms, and Auntie Badia showered me with adoration. What poem shall you recite for me this evening, she would ask. Take care of your Auntie Badia, who loves you most of all. She loved me, and she showed it. I loved her right back. but not enough. Not enough, because even then, when the Austrian or Australian finished, when the Englishman had left a deposit in one illicit container or another, when the Russian returned to the lounge to wait for friends, to settle up a bill or gather his wits, then the American noticed me. I was there with Auntie Badia. Such a cute boy, the German, the Swede would say, so adorable. The man looked slightly less kempt than when he walked in, more sated. He exuded confidence. He smiled at me, a smile stronger than destiny. Such a cute kid, such a sweet boy. I loved Auntie Badia. I loved my mother, but I worshipped the man. I made him my religion. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you very much for being here. I would like, first of all, to thank Rich Levy and InPrint for the wonderful privilege of reading for you tonight in this beautiful Alley Theater under the snow. It's always strange to read from my books in English for two reasons, mainly because, first of all, these are not my words, but those of my translator, the great Anne MacLean. I would like to give her due credit tonight. And secondly, because I published this book originally in Spanish 3.5 years ago. So it's almost as reading from somebody else's book. I hope I like it. Reputations is the story of Javier Mallarino, who is a very powerful political cartoonist in the Colombia of the 21st century. He is feared and respected by the political establishment. As the novel opens, he is being recognized and celebrated as a sort of moral conscience of the country. But then we get this flashback to learn a little bit about his origins, his first days in the business, in the trade of political cartoons. He begins to grow in his reputation, in his influence, until someday he begins having second thoughts about what he is doing. He begins asking himself, why does he keep on drawing these things? And this is where I start reading. That's when he received, in a single prodigious day, the answer to all his questions. He'd acquired the habit of walking around downtown in the afternoons, buying his daughter absurd stickers for an absurd album Magdalena, his wife, insisted she fill up, or getting his shoes shined and talking politics with the bootblacks, or simply watching life with a sort of hunger that demanded he stay out on the streets instead of returning to his morning seclusion, take off his jacket and feel his arms brush up against other arms and pick up the smell of living bodies. That afternoon was a Tuesday, which was the day of the week Mallarino would go to the Avianca building to collect his mail from his mailbox, the metallic, gray, deep little box that brought him boundless pleasure, like a magician's hat does a child, and later sit in some nearby cafe to read his magazines and answer his letters. He arrived at 7th Avenue by the National Library, and from there, along the eastern sidewalk, he began to walk south, sometimes noticing the noisy, disorderly, relentless city, sometimes so distracted that a building came into view almost unexpectedly, its long, straight lines penetrating the sky and struck on sunny afternoons by a dense light that seemed not of this world. As he went in, his hand would already be feeling for his keychain in his pocket and separating out the mailbox key so he wouldn't have to search for it in front of the cemetery wall of post boxes. And that's how it had gone that time. Mayarino made his way through the corridors, through their whitish lights, which drew circles under everyone's eyes, and turned to the little gray door. He stretched out his arm and his precise hand, that hand that could draw exact 90-degree angles without any instruments, and placed the tip of the key into the lock, the way a medieval knight would have put the tip of his lance against his rival's chest. But the key did not go in. He thought at first that he'd gone to the wrong box. He leaned down toward the little door and looked at the number on the metal tag with all its digits, the same as ever, the ones Mayarino knew by heart. He hadn't gotten it wrong. The revelation arrived late, like a careless guest. There was a shadow or texture that made him look more closely at the metallic surface. And only when he was inches away from the lock did he realize it had been blocked up with chewing gum. It was a hardened paste, it must have been there several days, that filled the slot without overflowing the edges, a conscientious piece of work. Mayarino touched the paste with the tip of the key, probed, pushed, scratched a little, tried a carving movement with his wrist, but got nowhere. The dried gum paste remained firm. "Hey, what a nasty trick to play on someone," said a voice, and Mayarino turned his head to find a gold tooth glinting in the middle of an unshaven face. "No way to fix that, huh? People have no respect these days." And Mayarino soon found himself climbing a model stairway, walking till he reached a counter, handing over his ID and watching as a petite woman went through books, opened drawers and closed them again, produced a photocopy of a form from somewhere and asked if Mayarino would be paying in cash or by check, turned a deaf ear when Mayarino protested and said he hadn't lost the key, that someone had put chewing gum in the lock, and the woman told him it was all the same to her, would he be paying cash or by check? Then there were stamps in purple ink, carbon paper, and pastel-colored receipts, time wasted in a hard and hostile plastic chair, and finally a shout ringing against the concrete walls. "Mayarino, Javier Mayarino." A skinny, grief-stricken locksmith, his overalls smelling of improperly dried clothes, went back with him to face the rebellious mailbox, took a series of unnameable tools from his leather belt, the metals giving off sparks under the neon lights. And what followed was the violation of the lock, or what Mayarino perceived as a violation, a violent and treacherous penetration of his private life, in spite of the fact that he'd given his authorization and consent, in spite of his being present during the whole process. He felt something like physical pain at the breaking of the lock, at the snap of the little door. He was saddened by the vulnerability of his collection of magazines looking at him imploringly from the shadowy depths. The latest Alternativa, the latest New Yorker, a back issue of Le Canard Enchaîné, a Parisian colleague had sent him. He wanted to leave and be home already, in his refuge, reading with a glass of beer, hearing or sensing the reassuring presence of his wife and daughter. But he still had to witness the installation of the new lock and get the new keys and sign more papers and put tips in faceless hands before going back out on 7th Avenue, carrying his leather bag slung across his chest, the back of his neck sweaty, his eyes tired from so much darkness. Later, he would think it had all begun with that tiredness, or the disorientation that always overwhelmed him after contending with the senseless bureaucracy of this country, or simply the white color of the envelope, that immaculate white, with no address, no writing of any kind, no stamps, no blue and red stripes that revealed a letter having arrived from abroad. He'd started taking the magazines out of his bag, impatient to begin leafing through them, and had his hands stuck inside it, fingers moving as if through a card catalog, head looking down to see the covers, when he noticed the corners sticking out between the pages. He stopped in the middle of the square, looked at the front and back of the envelope, then opened it. Javier Mayarino read the typed text of the letter with neither date nor address. With your warping of the truth, you have assaulted and discredited the armed forces of our republic, playing into the hands of the enemy. You are an unpatriotic liar, and we hereby notify you that the patience of those who are loyal to our country is wearing thin. We know where you live and where your daughter goes to school. We will not hesitate to punish with the harshest severity any further infringements against our honor. On the last line, over to the right, with no regards, no sincerely, no yours faithfully, a single word that seemed to be shouting from the page, patriots. The first thing he did when he got home was to show Magdalena the letter, and he knew she was genuinely worried when she started making fun of the wording. Between the two of them, they tried to remember the last cartoon he'd drawn on a military subject. They had to go back several weeks to a series of three drawings in which a disconsolate horse was talking to a woman who was handling some iron structures. Mayarino had drawn those scenes after Felisa Burstin, a Bogotá sculptor famous for working with scrap iron, had been accused of subversive activities, imprisoned in the army's stables, manhandled and humiliated, and later forced into exile. Magdalena and Mayarino propped the originals up on the long living room sofa and spent a good while looking at them, as if wishing they could vanish from the recent past. That night they were so frightened that they dragged a mattress into their bedroom so Beatriz, who had just turned 6, could go to bed there. And the family slept like that, heaped up in the insufficient space, breathing stale air all night with their pressed wood door securely locked. Days of paranoia would follow, Mayarino looking over his shoulder on the city streets and returning home before dark. But later, when the memory of the threat began to fade away, what they'd remember would be the reaction of Rodrigo Valencia, the newspaper editor, who'd burst out laughing on the other end of the phone line when Magdalena called him the day after the note to tell him what had happened. Mayarino watched Magdalena furrow her brow, the telephone stuck to her ear, then heard her faithfully relay the message. Rodrigo says, congratulations, you finally made it. He says you're nobody in this country until somebody wants to hurt you. Thank you. Thank you very much. So the second and last section of the book takes place a little later. Some years later, when Mayarino is already high in his degree of influence, in his position as a political commentator, he is having a private party at his home. His daughter is running around with one of her friends. He's surrounded by his own friends and colleagues. And suddenly one of them looks at the door and says, what's that guy doing here? It was Adolfo Cuellar, a conservative congressman he'd drawn many times over the last few years and with a certain frequency a few months back, enough to know by now his large ears, the childish freckles on his face, and the severe line of his slicked over hair. His reputation had turned him into a target of several attacks from the liberal press. Few public men carried their reputations the way Cuellar carried his, standing on his shoulder like a parrot. No, draped around his neck, the way a snake charmer carries his snake. Maybe that's what a reputation is, thought Mayarino, the moment when a presence fabricates for those observing an illusory precedent. Mayarino's last caricature had appeared after a nurse had been beaten to death by her husband with a large hoe in a village in Valledupar. It's very regrettable, said Cuellar into a journalist's microphone. But when someone hits a woman, it's generally for a reason. Mayarino had drawn him standing in a forest of tombstones with an oversized head on which his freckles and hair were easily distinguished, wearing a three-piece suit and carrying a garden hoe in one hand. In the background, sitting on a rock in a posture denoting insurmountable tedium, was Death, with his long black cloak and his scythe held in his folded arms. When one is out of work, read the line beneath the image, it's generally for a reason. And now the man of the hoe, as a columnist had already called him, was in Mayarino's house. What's that guy doing here? Gerardo Gomez had asked. That's what I'd like to know, said Mayarino. Or maybe he didn't get the whole sentence out. That's what I'd like, he managed to say, and at that moment he saw Rodrigo Valencia, the editor, wipe his mouth with a paper napkin. Above his upper lip, a trail of white specks had stuck to his badly shaven skin, and clear his throat with a touch of comic intent. I invited him, said Valencia. Mea culpa, Javier. I forgot to warn you. What do you mean you invited him? Said Mayarino. Well, he called me on Friday, man. He called to beg me. That he needed to speak to Señor Mayarino, that I had to get him a meeting with Señor Mayarino. He pestered me so damn much, he left me no choice. Wait, wait one second. A meeting? You've got to understand, man. It's what it was like the guy was on his knees over the phone. But on a Sunday, said Mayarino, today, on a Sunday, here in my house, have you gone mad, Rodrigo? There was no other way to get rid of him. He's a congressman, Javier. He's an idiot. He's a congressional idiot, okay, said Valencia. Speak to him for 2 seconds, that's all I'm asking. At least the guy was civil enough to show up after lunch. Not to eat my food, you mean? Exactly, Javier, said Valencia. Not to eat your food. Mayarino went inside out of courtesy, the host advancing to receive the recent arrival, and at the same time as prevention to keep the recent arrival from being seen in the place where the party was taking place and feeling mistakenly that he was welcome. He greeted Cuellar, a chubby, flaccid hand, a gaze that fixed on Mayarino's left shoulder. His hair was shorter than it seemed from a distance. Mayarino saw the broad forehead completely clear. A slight smudge of Brill cream on the left temple, a fruit fly caught in a spider web. And later, seeing him turn around to sit down, he noticed a bulge at the back of his head, as if something were struggling to get out, though. Something ugly, no doubt, a secret, a devious past. Everything about the little man made him feel an intense disgust. He was grateful to be taller than him, thinner, more elegant in spite of his inattention to his wardrobe. Thanks for seeing me, Javier, the little man was saying, on a Sunday for crying out loud and you with guests. My pleasure, said Mayarino, but I would ask you not to call me by my first name. You and I don't know each other. There was a sort of clumsiness in the man's movements. No, of course, he said, precisely. And then, can I take my jacket off? He did, and Mayarino found himself looking at a linen waistcoat with a blue and green diamond pattern straining violently over a prominent pot belly. Mayarino, in his caricatures, had never taken advantage of these recently discovered curves and thought he would next time. He led Cuellar to a corner of the room closest to the kitchen, and there, on two chairs not positioned to be used, but just to go with the telephone table, they sat down to talk. Mayarino felt around and turned on the lamp. In this part of the house, far from the big window overlooking the garden, you could tell that evening was starting to fall. The yellow light illuminated Cuellar's face and bones and skin, which cast new shadows as he moved. Cuellar bent over to adjust one of his loafers. Maybe it was swallowing his sock, thought Mayarino. That could be very uncomfortable. And then straightened up again. "Look, Señor Mayarino," he began to say, "I wanted to meet you, wanted us to meet, because it seems to me that you have a, how should I put this, a mistaken image. Of me, of course, a mistaken image of me." Mayarino listened to him while looking for a couple of clean glasses and poured two double shots of whiskey, a matter of not neglecting his duties as host, even for a man and worthy of them. From the garden came the sound of a woman's loud laugh. Mayarino looked up to see who it was. Cuellar, however, wiped his palms on his trousers, his fingers spread out as if he hoped Mayarino would notice the cleanliness of his nails, and kept talking. "I am not the person you draw in your caricatures. I'm different. You don't know me." "That's what I just said," said Mayarino. "You and I don't know each other." "We don't know each other," said Cuellar, "and it seems to me that you've been unfair to me. Forgive me for saying this. I'm not a bad person, you understand? I'm a good person. Ask my wife. Ask my children. I have two boys. Ask them, and you'll see they'll say so, that I'm a good person. Poor little guys, I don't show them your drawings. My wife doesn't show them. Forgive me for telling you this. I'm sorry." Mayarino could barely believe it. The man had come on a supplicant mission. "He called to beg me," Valencia had said. It was like the guy was on his knees over the phone. Mayarino felt invaded by a solid contempt, as palpable as a tumor. What was annoying him so much? Was it perhaps the humility with which Adolfo Cuellar was speaking to him, head bent, casting a shadow under his nose, arms resting on his knees, the pose of someone confessing to a friendly priest, a sinner before his confessor? Or perhaps the respect with which Cuellar was treating him in spite of the fact that Mayarino obviously felt none? "I've humiliated him, I've ridiculed him, and now he's come to lick my ass. What a repugnant man." Yes, that was it, an unpredictable and thus more intense repugnance, a repugnance for which Mayarino was not prepared. He had expected complaints, protests, even diatribes. A few minutes earlier, he had greeted this man with a measure of hostility just to better face up to the other's hostility. Like an employee who caught in the wrong arrives at the supervisor's office gesticulating and shouting, launching little precautionary attacks. Well, now it seemed that Cuellar had come here not to demand the immediate cessation of those aggressive drawings, but to humiliate himself even further before his aggressor. "He's an adult," thought Mayarino, "a grown man, and I have humiliated him. He has a wife and kids, and I have ridiculed him, and this adult man does not defend himself. This head of a family does not respond with similar blows, but humiliates himself even more, seeks even more ridicule." Mayarino found himself feeling a confusing emotion that went beyond contempt. Something that wasn't irritation or annoyance, but seemed dangerously close to hatred. And it alarmed him to be feeling it. "Please, Javier, please don't draw me like that anymore. I'm not like that," Cuellar was saying. "That's what I came to ask you, Señor Mayarino," he corrected himself with a shaky and nervous voice, nervous like Beatriz when she licked the dry skin of her hands. "Thank you for listening to me. Sorry for your time. I mean, thank you for your time." Mayarino listened to him and thought, He's weak. He's weak, and that's why I hate him. He's weak, and I'm strong now, and I hate him for making the fact so obvious, for allowing me to abuse my strength, for giving me away, yes, for exposing this power that maybe I don't deserve. Seen from the seat, the sliding door to the garden had turned into a big illuminated rectangle, and Mayarino saw, against the bright backdrop, the silhouettes that now began to enter. "The day's cooled down now," he heard someone say. The house filled with lively conversations, open and more discreet laughter. Someone asked where the record player was, and someone else, Gomez or Valencia, began to sing without waiting for musical accompaniment. "I saw you arrive," he sang, and felt the presence of an unknown being. It was a song his wife liked. But there was no way Valencia or Gomez knew that, or knew that those lines were forcing Mayarino to remember his absent wife, the profound emptiness that was opening in his life without her, and to regret everything, to regret it intensely. Adolfo Cuellar was just apologizing again for taking Mayarino's time, for invading his house on a Sunday. He was talking about a father's image for his children and how his sons would grow up with Mayarino's image of him. "Do it for them," Cuellar was saying. "As a father yourself, please," he asked or begged. And Mayarino saw his ears, his nose, the bones of his forehead and temples, and thought of the strange disdain those bones and cartilage produced in him, and said to himself that even if Adolfo Cuellar didn't strike him as a repugnant little character, he would keep drawing him nonstop, and his bones and cartilage were to blame. "His bones are to blame," thought Mayarino. "It's always the fault of bones and cartilage. And then, bones are the only things that matter. In them, in the shape of the skull and the angle of the nose, in the width of the forehead and the strength or trepidation of a jaw and the dimples on a chin, their delicate or brusque slopes, their more or less intense shadows, there lies the reputation and the image. Give me a bone and I shall move the world. Politicians not know it. They haven't realized it yet. Or maybe they have, but it's not something they can fix. We are born with these bones. It's very difficult to change them. And so we'll go through life with the same vulnerabilities, or always forcing ourselves to compensate for them. Didn't someone say that a successful man is simply someone who has found a way to conceal a complex? In the living room, standing next to a crouching body that was manipulating old newspapers to light, for the first time, a fire in the fireplace of the new house, Rodrigo Valencia was singing at the top of his voice the lines of the song about a love that wasn't fire and wasn't flame, and those other lines which Magdalena loved so much, about the distances that separate cities and cities that destroy customs. And with each line, Mayarino had the impression that Adolfo Cuellar, who now took a sip of his drink and made a grotesque grimace as he swallowed, fell lower and lower in humiliation and shamelessness. A burst of flames reddened the room. Cuellar was incredible. How could he inflict such pains on himself, or was he not overwhelmed by any pain at kneeling before someone who'd wounded him? Mayarino was on the verge of asking him roughly when there was a sound of breaking glass. And before Mayarino had time to discover where it had come from, Elena Ronderos appeared, taking long strides and moving her hands as if wiping a clumsy phrase off a blackboard. "Hey, Javier, come quickly," she said. "Something's wrong with the girls." Thank you very much.
Yeah. Well, thank you for those two wonderful readings. We really enjoyed them. And I want to welcome you, Juan, to Houston for the first time and to welcome you back, Rabih.
Thank you.
Did you enjoy the readings?
Thank you very much.
Now, it's very interesting to me that neither of you started off as writers. You were an engineer, you were a lawyer. So how did this journey take place? Share a little bit of this with us. Juan, you want to start?
Well, actually, I did start as a writer. I started writing when I was 8. But when I was growing up in Colombia, when I graduated from high school, it wasn't easy, it wasn't even possible to say, I want to be a novelist. I want to write novels for a living. This was not how you did it. Particularly coming from a family with a very strong lawyerly tradition in which everybody's a lawyer. My mother is a lawyer, my father is a lawyer, my sister is a lawyer, my brother-in-law is a lawyer. Dinners are horrible in my family. So what I did was, what I thought I should do, what I thought my life would be like, was going to law school and even becoming a lawyer, and writing and reading in my spare time. And then there came a time in the middle of my studies, in the exact middle of the third year of law school, in which I realized that literature was not a hobby for me, that it wasn't a thing to do in my spare time, but rather a vocation, a true calling, that it demanded that I turn my whole life around to make literature the center of it instead of something in the periphery. So I never got to work as a lawyer in any way. This is when I decided that I should leave the country. I went to Paris, I studied literature in Paris, and I began trying to write novels. So it's not that I started as something else, it's that it was a detour, that the law studies.
And what did your family say when you made this decision?
Well, they were scared, as I would be, if my daughters said, hey, we want to become poets or something. But I think they realized that they had force-fed me novels since I was really very little. It was a family of readers. Books were all over the place. Writers were people who mattered in my home. So they really, I guess they thought they didn't have any moral authority to oppose my desire to become a writer. So they were very supportive. Sometimes I hope they were less supportive. It would make for better storytelling right here with you. But no, they helped me, they supported me. Yeah.
Wonderful. How about your journey?
Similar. Although, again, for unlike lawyers in Lebanon, in the Middle East, there are two jobs that one can take. You're either a doctor or an engineer. Those are the two professions. Anything else is if you fail school, that's what you become. So that's what I did. I worked for 6 months as an engineer with a 5 months vacation in between. But I actually don't think that's a bad thing. I don't like the idea of being a writer as a job. This whole career as a writer and its planned, I would have hated it had I done it. I've never taken a writing class, and I'm terrible at giving writing classes. The whole idea is it's a matter of reading. And I became a writer because I got tired of not seeing my story in the books that I was reading. That's basically it. My father, when I was, before he died, he reminded me that when I was 4, he asked me what I wanted to be, and I said I wanted to be a writer. And at that time, it was about writing Superman comics, because that's what I was reading. Yeah. So it's basically reading, and then I could do better than this. I can do better than this, which it's not necessarily...
And Superman comics?
Oh, God, yes, I can do better than Superman. but yeah, that's how it starts.
Well, both of you were born in other countries from here, and then you moved away from those countries. And in some ways, you write about those places as well. What do you think living away from the countries that you were born in, what was the effect of that on your writing? Did it help you? Did it hinder you? Did it change your vision? And for you now, you've gone back to Bogota, and you have a home here, of course, in San Francisco, but also in Cairo, is it?
No, Beirut.
In Beirut.
No, it's all the same. It's important. It's been important for me, primarily because I believe that a writer has to be both separate from the community or the culture that one is writing about and also belong to it. It's a straddling thing. If one is too much outside of the culture, one cannot see it clearly. And if one is too enmeshed in a culture, one cannot see it either. One, you don't have to leave a culture to have that distance, but it does help. And then, you know, you could go back to the culture like he does, and you still have that distance until it comes a time where you get so enmeshed. For me, when I go back to Lebanon, I'm able to see my family a little bit. But then after about 2 months, I'm unable to see them. They become the family that I grew up with. And all of a sudden, I can't see them clearly. So I can't write about them. And it's hell if you can't write about your family, because that's my one revenge.
And I believe when you live there, they come and take over your house.
Yes, we do not have, shall we say, separate abodes. My family, we're so close, my sisters and I mean, and they've saved my life a number of times. And my house is theirs, and they're very proud of it.
Well, I was talking before how the first decision I took when I realized that I wanted to become a novelist was leaving the country. This is completely arbitrary, but it sort of goes with the trade if you're a Latin American. For some reason, we have grown accustomed to the idea that if you want to become a writer, you leave. And particularly readers such as myself who grew up with under the great phenomenon of the Latin American boom. I don't know if that's familiar to you. The Latin American boom is that generation of novelists, including Gabriel García Márquez, Mario Vargas Llosa, Carlos Fuentes, Julio Cortázar, and their forebears, Jorge Luis Borges, Juan Rulfo. This amazing generation of Latin American writers. All of them except Borges, and certainly all of them in that generation that started publishing wonderful books at the end of the 50s, García Márquez, Vargas Llosa, Cortázar, Carlos Fuentes, left their countries in order to write better or to understand better what they were writing about their countries. So we had this situation in which the best Colombian novel, 100 Years of Solitude, was written in Mexico. The best Peruvian novel by Mario Vargas Llosa was written in London, and the best Mexican novel by Carlos Fuentes was written in Washington and Havana. So there's something that there's something about Latin America, probably in the way in the position writers have in Latin America, that makes it very profitable, in a way, for us to leave, to become writers and grow up as novelists elsewhere, all the time writing about our countries.
Do you feel being somewhere else gives you more freedom to write what you want?
That's one of the things. Yes, definitely.
I'm banned in a number of countries. It's like, duh. But soon we will have it here. I'm just starting. The evening is just starting.
Coming soon to a theater near you.
Yes, it partly.
Oh, that's so sad.
The partly it's that, but again, it's the distance. It's the being able to see to see clearer. And again, you don't have to leave to be able to do that. You could be an outsider in your own culture. That would also work.
Yeah.
Just that you need a little bit of a distance. You can't be completely enmeshed in a culture.
Mm-hmm. So now both of you are also very aware of the traditions, the literary traditions that you come from. And you, in your book, The Hakawati, you've written about that. And you just mentioned all these great writers of your tradition. What do you see as your relationship with your literary tradition?
It's a contact sport. It's
violent sometimes.
A violent one.
Yeah, it should be violent. I think one of the things we do as writers is, in a way, reinvent our own tradition, invent new ways of reading the books that matter the most to us. But I've always thought of my tradition as being quite different from my language also. I feel at home in the tradition of Latin American literature, which I grew up with, all these writers that I have mentioned. But I also feel at home in the English language, and the writers that matter the most to me in the English language are as important to me as my Latin American writers. I don't know, Joseph Conrad is as important for me as Jorge Luis Borges. Mm-hmm. And among the living, if I had to pick two writers that I have that have shaped my ideas about my trade, I would have to think of Mario Vargas Llosa, but in the same line there would be Philip Roth, for instance. Mm-hmm. Or So tradition is something you build for yourself. You build this family around you, and it doesn't have to belong to your own language. This is something that I think about often when people ask me about the influence of García Márquez on my work. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you were planning to do that.
I was.
Yeah. In fact, I knew you were planning to do that, but I wasn't. The idea of the influence of García Márquez on the next generations of Colombian writers, I think, springs from a misunderstanding, and that's the idea that influence has this territorial quality. So if you're born within the borders of a certain place, you must suffer the influence of the great writer from that place. I often say this is not the case. I ask people to remember that it's influence, not influenza. So it's not contagious. It's not this virus that falls on you. And I have written essays in which I try to explore the idea that the way it works is exactly the opposite. Writers choose their influences. Mm-hmm. And so just in the same way as García Márquez didn't writes in his first novels under the influence of any Colombian novel, but chose Faulkner and Kafka and Hemingway as masters. Well, I chose to learn some things from García Márquez, but to learn other things from Conrad or Fitzgerald or Joyce. Mm-hmm. Or French writers who have had an influence on my work. So I completely forgot where I was going with this, but
it was important.
It was important for me to say it. Yeah.
You came to a good place.
Yes. Great. Thank you.
I think one of the important things about both of us is the tradition for me is the tradition of reading, of actually reading books. So I've never been influenced much by Lebanese writers or Arab writers because my home is books. You know, so I could probably say, I'm not sure, but I could probably say that Marquez was probably a bigger influence on me than on him. It's like I found home in Rushdie, I found home in Naipaul, in all kinds of things that were not, but I do know the traditions of where I come from, and I both, you know, sort of glorify it and rebel against it, because I read. That I find a lot of problems these days with a lot of the writers who don't, you know, haven't read everything that I think every writer should read.
Yeah, yeah. I want to become a writer, but I don't like to read. What should I do? You should run for president. You know?
I was planning to be nice this evening, but then. So yes, it's in terms of tradition, it's the tradition of literature. I don't care who influences you, but it's rarely literature of my home country. Or for me, I'm actually literature of America. I mean, there are certain writers that biggest influence on my work are neither American nor Lebanese, even though those are my two homes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Now, Ravi, you've said there's a danger in writing what you know.
Yes. Mm.
And Juan, you've said my novels always stem from personal experience. Can you discuss this a little bit?
Yeah. Yeah. They do. And at the same time, I completely agree with Ravi.
Mm-hmm. And I completely agree with him.
Sometimes I even agree with myself, which is... yes, all my novels are born from experiences, from people I meet, stories I hear, things I go through. But this is far from meaning that... my novels stem from a position of knowledge. Good literature almost never begins as certainties. We don't write novels because we know things. We write novels because we have questions, because we have uncertainties, because we have doubts, because we want to explore dark areas of our experience. Of course, we know those experiences, that these things have happened to us. But you get to a moment in which something you thought you knew becomes mysterious, becomes unclear. Or from the first moment you know this person you have just met, this story you have just heard, this experience you have just been through has more shadows than light in it, and you write about it. You never write about things that you know for sure, that are absolutely clear for you. You write in order to know, in order to illuminate dark places in your experience.
I will add further that after I've written, I still don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the really important. The thing about, for me, the statement, write what you know is dangerous, comes from the fact that a lot of writing programs, that's what they insist on, that you write from your own experience and write what you know. Granted, I too, of course, write from things that happen to me or that I imagine. The characters are never really that far from my position or whatever. But the truth of the matter is, I know nothing, and most writers, their lives are terribly boring. I mean, you know, it's like if I write what I know, I can tell you what my cats like to eat. You know, I can tell you what it's like to get up in the morning and, you know, go to the bathroom and scope, you know, should I have Metamucil now or after? This is my life. If I write what I know, it's like I'll be bored to tears. Yeah. So, you know, you imagine these things, but like, you know, so that's why Satan visits my books.
So in both of these last books of yours, the ones you read from, memory is an important theme.
Yeah.
And can you talk a little bit about why writing about memory is important to you? What are you saying about the power of memory? Or
yeah. Well, I would say there are two levels. There's the level of obsessions, which is not really clear to you. I mean, I don't know why the past and our difficult relationship with the past and the fact that I once made this great discovery and very frightening discovery that the past moves around. It doesn't stay put. We grow up with this idea that the past is the only thing we can be sure of, right? We even write songs about this. Lo que pasó, pasó is a very famous bolero in Spanish. So the past is set in stone. There is no such thing. The past moves around, it changes. We hear a story, we find a letter, a photograph, and the people in our past begin changing, start changing. So perhaps it's that, I'm not sure why, our only window into the past, which is memory, has become such an obsession for me, but all my novels deal with this. So there's an irrational side to it that I can't really explain. But on a rational side, as a reader of novels and literature, I have become aware that memory, that literature is the guardian of memory, in a way, particularly in countries such as mine and in Latin America in general.
In the US.
We'll go there if you want to later. We have, as countries, we have a difficult relationship with the past. Our powers that be try to hide it, try to tell stories about it, try to distort it, try to suppress uncomfortable moments in the past, try to distort the truth, the historical truth. And literature has traditionally been the place where citizens, where we as citizens raise our hands and we say, it is not how you are telling it. Mm-hmm. Or we say, don't forget this. Or we say, you are telling lies. So from this political / philosophical point of view, the relationship between literature and memory is absolutely indispensable. It is the way we defend ourselves from the way power, that thing we call power, tells the story. And the way they tell the story is usually history with a capital H. Mm-hmm. So we have to be very vigilant in that. And this is what novels in Latin America have been doing for a long time.
This is what novels have been doing a lot of places for a long time. The thing that, everything he said is absolutely right on, and I don't want to repeat it. I mean, all my novels, every single one of them talks about memory. I don't talk about anything else. but primarily it's because we live in an age of forgetting, particularly now. In Latin America, the reason it's so obvious is because they're not as good, the governments are not as good as they are over here. And we are experts over here at making people forget. You know, I mean, it got to the point in the last election thing that people were forgetting what was happening the day before. You know, we would get this big scandal, and then the next day, well, what about those emails? The big scandal, what about those emails? It got to be so ridiculous that people were not remembering some of the horrible things that happened in you know, 2 days beforehand, let alone what happened. So that all of a sudden, there's a concentrated effort on making people forget. And this is not just in this election, and you know, I could talk about this forever and ever and ever, but for a long, long time. We are in the process right now of bombing five different countries that we know nothing about. We do not remember. The reason I wrote a book about the AIDS crisis is because it's really surprising how many young gay men have no clue. Okay? It is not taught anywhere. It is presented as this tough time that happened. And then my favorite is that there were a lot of people who were talking about how we all came together to pull ourselves out of the... Nobody pulled together, okay? We were left to die on our own, okay? We were left to die on our own. And everybody now wants to take credit for how wonderful we were during the AIDS years. Okay? So this is what novels does. It's the idea of what is remembering and who gets to remember and who gets to tell the stories. What novelists can and cannot do is we can tell the stories. I don't know how many people are listening, but we can tell our version. And that is all through working through memory. What was it like? So that's what it is.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you both. We're just about out of time here, so I want to ask you a final question. As our conversation here has indicated, we are at a strange moment in our nation's history here in America, where diversity is being threatened. Hate crimes against minorities have spiked recently. What would you say to writers at this time? What role can writers play at this time?
Well, I've always thought this is writers in my tradition, in the Latin American tradition, tend to feel less hostile at the idea that novels have actually a role to play in the shaping of a society. We haven't. This is one of the things that separate a little bit. I'm not talking about two big teams in the world, but literature in the continental European tradition and literature in the English language tradition have this different view on the political role of the writer. I would urge those writers to take a political stance, to become not to be afraid of becoming intellectuals. One thing is the novelist, but novelists in my tradition are also citizens, and as citizens, they become this thing, the public intellectual, who is not afraid to debate, to get into the fight, through columns, through different forms of activism. But novels in themselves are one of the best instruments we have invented as human beings to change societies. It's a slow change. It happens individual by individual, but it happens. Milan Kundera, an extraordinary Czech writer, talks about in one of his essays of how, talks about
how European societies think of themselves as the inventors of human rights. But he says, in order for human rights to be invented, first we had to discover each other as individuals. Individuals with equal dignities, equal inalienable rights, people born in more or less the same philosophical conditions, the same equality in the world. And this, says Kundera, this we wouldn't have been able to achieve if it wasn't for the novel, for that amazing machine that taught us empathy, that taught us to think about somebody else who is very different from ourselves, to live in the mind of a Russian student who murders an old woman like Raskolnikov, or to live in the mind of a bored French housewife like Madame Bovary. For 400 pages, we live with her. The amount of training in empathy that the activity as readers of novels has given us, I think, has been instrumental in the creation of what we call the civilized world, of tolerance, of solidarity. So novels have a role to play, and I would urge young writers to embrace that idea. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, now it's my turn. I would either urge them either to stop, just stop. If you can't think of anything to do, just stop. Because for me, one of the more interesting quotes is from an essay by Philip Roth, which at the time I didn't understand why there was just this one sentence that I disliked. It said something to the effect, he's talking about Eastern European literature, and he said that there is an urgency that they have because their writing is a matter of life and death. And I would like writers to consider that writing is a matter of life and death. Every book that I write is, I think this is the last book I'll ever be able to write, because I have no idea not just what's going to happen next, but that it's just, so what is it that I want to say? What I find interesting is that for a lot of American writers, the thought never enters the mind. It's just that, oh, I'm going to write about a couple in Minneapolis who are having some tension in whether they'll do the dishes or not. There is nothing wrong with that kind of writing. There is absolutely nothing wrong with it. Please enjoy it. But unless what you write is urgent, in this day and age, it's like, you know, we just have to say welcome to the world. You mean, come on. What we have, if what you have to say is not the most urgent thing right now, you know, write for TV. It pays better. You'll be much more accepted, you'll be much better known, and people will like you, and you don't get hate mail. Otherwise, it's not worth it. You know, again, writing, unless it is urgent, unless, you know, when I'm working, there is nothing I can do. It drives me crazy. I begin to see my psychoanalyst 4 times a week. And unless, you don't have to see a psychoanalyst, but unless it is urgent, unless it is really important for you, do something else. I mean, again, there are just a lot of lovely things you could do. Flower arranging is wonderful. It's much healthier, you'll feel better, and you do something pretty.
Thank you both for this wonderful reading and this wonderful, thought-provoking, and fun conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.